your baby boy will one day walk on water. Mary, did you know that your baby boy will save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you delivered will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby boy will give sight to a blind man?
Mary, did you know
that your baby boy will calm a storm with his hand?
Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? When you kiss your little baby, you've kissed the face of God.
Oh, Mary, did you know?
Oh, Mary, did you know? Ooh, the blind will see. You know
that your baby boy will one day rule the nation.
Did you know?
Did you know that your baby boy
is heaven's perfect land? The sleeping child you're holding
is the great
I've heard about this baby boy who's come to earth to bring us joy, and I just want to sing this song to you. Emmanuel has come to earth, the Virgin Mary given birth into a world that sings a hallelujah. 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 Came to Bethlehem, a expecting child, they search the air to find a place for you. We're coming soon. There was no room for them to stay, so in a manger filled with hay, God's only son was born. Oh, hallelujah. Flocks by night to see this baby wrapped in light. A host of angels led them all to you. It was just as the angel said, you'll find him in a manger bed. Emmanuel. Shone bright up in the east to Bethlehem. The wise men three came many miles and journeyed long for you. And to the place at which you were, the frankincense and golden myrrh they gave to you. Rescue me, this baby boy would grow to be a man and one day die for me and you. My sins would drive the nails in you. That rugged cross was my cross too. Still every breath you drew was
weekend, and we have some visitors here with us today, all the way from Arizona. It's good to have Harvey with us, Dorothy Hess's son and oldest son. And so everybody turn around and say, hi, Harvey.
Hi, Harvey. Welcome, Harvey.
And it's so good having, I know Dorothy and Harvey are so happy to see him during this time. But aren't you glad that, oh, come, Emmanuel, the virgin will give birth to a son and will call him Emmanuel, which means what? God with us. Amen.
Until the Son of God appeared.
Christ Emmanuel.
Oh, come thou day-spring, come thy, and order all things far and nigh. To us the path of knowledge show, and cause us in the ways to
sing it out.
Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to
today, that one of these days, and how if we have ever needed it, it is today, when peace shall over all the earth, right? Its ancient splendors fling. We're going to fling back the song up to heaven that the angels sang, and the whole world gives back that song which now the angels sing. So, Lord Jesus, we are praying that Maranatha come soon, Lord Jesus, and that we may see and hear and know that you, the King of Kings, sit on the throne, and all the nations will come, and all the nations will come and give you glory as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And then we'll echo back the song the angels sang those 2,000 years ago, peace on earth, goodwill toward man. Amen. 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 You may be seated, church.
Amen. Well, good morning, church.
Good morning.
Good morning. Praise God. God inspired the prophets of old that they should foretell of his great promise of a Messiah. Many generations of people lived in expectation, hoping that the promise will be fulfilled in their day. We also live in a day of anticipation, knowing that Christ will return to us, perhaps even in our lifetime.
Amen. That's right.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Glory
Hallelujah.
To God.
Thank you. First Sunday of Advent, always anticipation of this season. I'll tell you, if we've ever needed the hope of Christmas, it is what? Today, right? Right now, this day, this very day. So the same call that went out to the shepherds long ago from the angels when they sang that midnight song, okay? And the shepherds said what? Let us go to Bethlehem to see this thing which the Lord has made known to us. And so the same call goes out today. Oh, come, all ye faithful. Let's sing it together.
Oh, come.
be seated. I'm going to just stay here at the piano since I'm kind of stuck here today. In a good way, stuck. Hallelujah. Emmanuel, God with us, and we give him glory today. And in the midst of the difficulties and struggles of this season that we have found ourselves in, we have eyes on Jesus today, right? Emmanuel, God with us. Oh, come, let us adore him. Christ the Lord, Christ Messiah, the Lord Jesus Christ. There is no other hope for this world. Christ in us, the hope of glory today. Amen. Amen. So it is with joy and expectancy that we come this first Sunday of Advent, and we come and we with anticipation. I tell you, I was going through all the different songs, the Christmas songs, and I promise you, once we get all of our AV stuff back, we will be singing some of those other songs we really love on the video songs. But I was just thinking today, wow, aren't you glad, aren't you thankful today that Jesus gave up the splendors of heaven? He gave it all up for you and for me, for this whole world. And if this world has ever needed hope, it is today, the hope of Christmas. And the one thing I love about this season is, even though you're listening to maybe secular radio and all the Christmas songs, this is the only time you're going to hear a bunch of Christian songs being sung over the airwaves. You hear, "Oh, come, Emmanuel." You hear all those. You hear, "Hark the herald angels sing." You hear, "Away in the manger." You hear those songs. And this is the only time that a lot of those people out in the world hear the good news of Jesus Christ. Amen? And so with anticipation, we're hoping and believing that this Christmas season is going to be joyous and hopeful. And I cannot wait for us to gather on Christmas Eve. I can tell you, church, it's going to be a beautiful, blessed event. We come together and we worship that night, above all nights, the night that Jesus Christ was born. Amen? So, the banner that's up there, it says it all. Christ is Christmas. Amen. There is no other reason why we would even be celebrating this season if it were not for Jesus Christ, right? So we speak his name, Yeshua, Adonai, Messiah. We love you, Jesus, Lord, the Lord Jesus Christ. We love you. We thank you for the hope that you give to us in the midst of our despair and hopelessness and the tragedy and difficulties and struggles all around us and the questions that we have. We give you praise today. Amen. So as we come and gather around the altar this morning, and there are a lot of needs listed there in the bulletin for you, we want to be lifting those up. And we mentioned some others, I know, in our Sunday school classes today. But I just want you to know, Emmanuel is with you. He says, "I will never leave you, and I will never forsake you." Be of good courage today. Be of good courage today. "I will never leave you, I'll never forsake you." And I don't know what difficulties you might be going through, what struggles, what's going on in your life. I know what's going on in my life. And let me tell you, I've got a lot of stress. Anybody have stress these days? Anybody going through a lot of stress these days? Let me tell you, there's a lot of stress going around. And I've had a lot of sleepless nights here lately, but you know what? In the midst of all of this, he promised, "I will never leave you and I will never forsake you." Be of good courage, good cheer today. "I am with you even until the very end of the age." I believe, friends, I believe that we are fighting for the life of our country today. And we have got to stand up, and we have got to count the cost. We have got to not be silent or cower or shrink back. Because let me tell you, the signs all around us are just like the signs in pre-Nazi Germany. Okay? Pre-Nazi Germany. They're all around us. And let me tell you, the church was silent. The church was silent in those days. And someone asked what the problem was of Dietrich Bonhoeffer, and he said, "It's cheap grace." It's cheap grace. In other words, we want our comfortableness, we want our good feeling, going to church, getting the good feeling, we go off and just, you know, everything's fine. You know, let me tell you, grace is costly. It cost Jesus Christ his very life, the only Son of God. It cost him everything. And the church was silent, and it did not stand up to what was wrong and going wrong in its nation. I do not want this church to be silent with what's going wrong in this nation. We've got to stand up and we've got to proclaim that there is a cost to following Jesus Christ. So what happened? They came after the Jews, right? Came after the Jews, stuck them on trains, took them off to the concentration camps. This is for you good. We're here to protect you. We're going to keep you safe. And then they came after. And they came after the evangelical Christians. And they came, and it's just like someone said, they came after the Jews and nobody stood up. They came after the Protestants and nobody stood up for them. They came up after the Catholics, nobody stood up for them. Then they came after me, and who was left to stand up for me? No one. Friends, it is time we stand up. We stand up. We take our rightful place. Faith is the victory that overcomes this world. And this earth shall tremble beneath the tread of the Christian. Amen? Come on, church! This first Sunday of Advent, now is not the time to be silent or to shrink back or to cower. Now is the time to stand up and count the cost and say, I will be counted for Jesus Christ. I am not ashamed of Jesus Christ or his gospel or that cross, because it is our only hope. It is our only hope. So I encourage you, whatever needs you might have here today, know that he is with you. He is with you. There's a lot of people that are sick, not feeling well, a lot of people traveling today. We're going to be lifting them up in prayer. Pray for those that are in the hospital and struggling and so forth. We're going to lift up Frank, and we want to lift up Barb Slankowskis' grandson and others, many others that are not feeling well. I think Dave said, you know, your kids are struggling. There's a lot of people that are struggling, but you know what? Eyes on Jesus, church. Eyes on Jesus. Eyes on Jesus. Not the problem, not the solution. You can't do anything about either one of them. Eyes on Jesus. He has the answer for it all. He knows why the problem exists, and he has the answer for the problem. Amen? So I want to encourage you, as we sing this beautiful, beautiful chorus here this morning, just want to encourage you to come gather around the altar and lift whatever needs you might have to the Lord in prayer. Turn right where you are and let's just seek the Lord in small groups this morning after you pray, Denise, okay? And if anybody wants to be anointed for any reason, feel free to come and sit at the front pew there and we'll know that you want to be anointed. Thank you, Jesus.
Father in heaven, we thank you for this Advent season and we ask, Lord, that you prepare our hearts. And may we fix our eyes in a gazing on you and not turn to the right,
that's right,
or to the left and keep our foot from evil. Oh Lord, may we walk on the narrow path and stay the course all the rest of our days. Lord, we pray that you hover over us with your holy unction poured out and your anointing upon us in this congregation this morning. I am praying, Lord, that your manifest presence comes and meets us right where we are, Lord. We sing a hallelujah to you, hallelujah. God. And Lord, we praise you and ask you to prepare us, Lord, for this season. Prepare our hearts to be ready and steadfast for you. Lord, I pray that you purge, cleanse, and purify each one of us and burn up the chaff, Lord. Yes. We pray you burn any chaff or any wicked way that is within us, oh God. And we humbly come to you in the holy and most precious name of Jesus and drop it at your feet and cast all of our cares upon you this morning, Lord. We pray, Lord, for miracles. We pray for the sick. We pray you set the captives free. We pray that people are delivered. We pray that you bind up the brokenhearted and that you cast out demons, Lord, and that blind eyes are open and prodigals are snatched from the fire and that they are brought into righteousness, God. Lord, raise up teachers and preachers and prophets and evangelists and apostles, God. Unleash your power upon us, God. Anoint us, God. We pray for those visions and dreams, God. We pray for them visions and dreams and sensitivity to your Holy Spirit. And we pray we have endurance to run this race and that you lift each and every one of us up on eagle's wings, Lord. Yes, Lord. And strengthen us where we are weak, for we know where we are weak, you are strong. So we thank you, Lord Jesus. And Lord, now we pray for our nation, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
We pray, Lord God, for a peace with each other and that you quiet us, our hearts, Lord, and that you help us to live godly lives and to have dignity, Lord God. And we pray for reformation for this nation. We pray for peace for this nation. We pray where there's chaos and disorder, Lord, that you come in, Lord, and reveal yourself to this nation, Lord. This nation was founded on Christian principles.
Yes,
and Lord, we just ask that we stay and remain and hold the line and stand up for our country and stand up for what is true. And that we stand and we lock arms together as Christian soldiers would and stand and march onward for the glory of God. When you said, when I come back, will there be any faith left?
That's right. Well,
I want to be that one.
Hallelujah, yes.
I want to be that one. And I know each and every one of you sitting here want to be that one. And you're saying, here I am, God. I will make a stand for you. I will make a stand for this country. I will make a stand for you, oh Jesus Christ, oh Lord and Savior, Lord God. Revival begins with us, Lord. It's not an event or a lifestyle, but it begins with us. And it's in you live and take up residency in our hearts. And we are sealed for the day of redemption. Lord, I praise you and I honor you and I thank you to start a fire in our heart.
Amen.
Revival
That's
fires
right.
across
That's
this nation. Awaken
yes,
your
Lord.
Church,
yes.
Lord.
Yes.
I pray for an awakened yes. church, not a dead church. This is an awakened church,
yes.
Lord. And we thank you that we
That's
are
right.
an awakened church, Lord God, and that we will continue to go out and bring in the sheaves, bring in the lost, Lord. Lord, we will be the hands and the feet of the Lord God Most High. Send us to do the Great Commission, Lord. We honor you and we glorify you.
Yes, we do.
Lord, I think of Frank today. I want to thank you because he's sitting up and he's in a chair.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah for progress, Lord. And even though he may have a way to go, we know that you can do the miraculous
yes.
and touch him
yes.
supernaturally, Lord. So we thank you for Frank, we thank you for his faithfulness that he has in you and his commitment, Lord. And Lord, like Pastor Joan, your word says, I will never leave you or forsake you. I am here to the end of the age. And I thank you for what you're doing in Frank's life. And I ask you to lift him up and heal his body, dear Lord. And I pray for Barb's grandson.
Yes, touch him, Jesus.
Oh, Lord, this was another miracle. Lord, you spared his life.
Yes, you did.
Even though he was in the ICU, Lord, you're raising him up off of his bedside of affliction, and we thank you for
Hallelujah.
That, Lord God. He's
yes.
a miracle. He's a walking miracle, and so is Frank, Lord God. Oh, Lord, even though he's got pins and screws, Lord God, we know this is temporal.
Yes.
This is a temporal thing, Lord God. So, Lord, however you choose to heal this boy, the most important thing, I pray you choose to heal his heart and that he is saved in the
yes,
name of
you,
Jesus Christ, Lord. And sometimes you use difficult circumstances, Lord, to draw us near to you. So we thank you, we honor you, we praise you, Lord God. And we pray that no plague comes near our dwelling, oh Lord. And I claim and believe Psalms 91 and over this whole congregation.
Amen. Thank you.
We thank you, we praise you, and we ask these things in Jesus' holy name this morning. Amen. And if anybody wants to come to be anointed this morning, please come forward to be anointed.
And then
and the intercessors.
Would, yes, yeah. And the intercessors come. And everybody else, if you just kind of turn right there and let's just lift whatever needs in your little circles. Just lift it to the Lord, just in your little groups there. Let's agree together today. And if you need to get up and move to join a circle, go ahead. And someone take the lead in your group and just lift up whatever needs.
You know the words.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We give you glory. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you, Jesus. We love you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Praise God.
Amen.
Oh, praise God. Whoa. Praise the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise him, O you servants of the Lord, you who stand in the house of the Lord, in the courts of the house of our God. Praise the Lord, for the Lord is good.
Yes.
Sing praises to his name, for it is pleasant.
Amen.
It is Psalms 135, 1 through 3. Will the ushers please come forward for the tithes and offerings, please? Thank you for that generous offering. And as you know, we're coming down to the end of this year, and so I want to encourage you in this final month of the year to make sure you give your year-end giving, and we definitely can use it, and we appreciate your faithfulness throughout all this time. You've been so tremendous, and we so appreciate it, and God bless you for it. I have a thank you card here from Rick and Amy, and I'll read it. It says, a special thank you. Every kindness has a part in bringing joy to someone's heart. Rick and I are so grateful to have a church family as special as all of you are in our lives. There are no words we express that can express how we appreciate the men of our church, Jim, Chuck, Pat, Pastor Bruce, Howard, and Brian. Thank you all so much for your time to come help with our roof. And you guys were just fantastic, so wonderful. Thank you, Pastor Joe, for your dedication to all of us. And although I didn't lift a finger over there, Amy, I was dedicated to the task, okay. Philippians 4:6, do not be anxious about anything. I love this scripture, Amy. But in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to God. Rick and I did, and God answered. Amen. God is good. Dear church family and men's ministry, then it says, it's sometimes easy to forget that there are nice people out there doing nice things for others. We have a great church that does all kinds of nice things for people. Amen. We love you all, Rick, Amy, and Christoph, and we love you guys. You know that. I think we showed that pretty well. By everything.
everything we did. And thank you for your financial support. Those of you who are not able to help physically, you helped financially in helping to make that possible for them. And praise his name for that. As you can see, the church is not really very decorated yet, and we apologize, but our builder is not completely done with our renovation here, and so rather than taking time to try to clean and to decorate, we only got a couple minor things out here just for the holiday for today, but hopefully by next Saturday, we will be decorating our church for the Advent season, okay? So at 2 o'clock next Saturday, Lord, hear our prayer, okay? And that is, all this will be done, it'll be good to go, and we'll have everything ready. And so if you are able, men and women, we really need your help, and just to finish decorating, because our church does look really beautiful. So right now it's a mixture of Thanksgiving and Christmas. So I don't know about that decor thing going on here, but anyway. But if you're able to help, 2 o'clock next Saturday. No lunch, though. No pizza. We're just going to come. We're going to work, get to it, and leave. Okay, right, Denise? Work, get to it, and leave. That's what we're going to do. And so, and then if I could have, I do need a couple men help me to move our banner up. And so if any of you are able to help me with that, I would greatly appreciate it. But it's looking great. It's looking beautiful. Not done yet. So encourage you to do that. So next Saturday, 2 o'clock. Next Sunday, though, is our missions luncheon and study time. And this is going to turn out great. We have a lot of Christmas cookies, so nobody bring dessert. Nobody bring desserts, okay? We have lots of Christmas cookies already, okay? So we have dessert. Just bring dishes, okay, so we can enjoy a nice meal together. And then there's a blue card like this in your bulletin, okay? And this is from Brother Abraham there, and this is concerning our Messianic congregation that meets here. And these are their Christmas, Advent and Christmas activities for the month. And this you want to keep on the fridge or pass out to someone and invite them and encourage them to come participate. He has assured me that the potato pancakes will not smell up my church this year. I don't quite believe him, but I didn't say that to him. But he promised me that he's trying a different recipe and not as much grease. Okay, and so, well, we'll see. I like them. Just the smell of them is a little powerful. But anyway, so if you want to learn how to make them, he's offering a class on how to make them, okay? So, Brother Joel, if you want to learn how to make Jewish potato pancakes, you're more than willing to come. And it's right here. Pass this out, okay? Encourage you to do that. And the rest, and your Bible reading's there. Saturating Pittsburgh is there as well. And then I do have, Brother Joel, would you get the clipboard there? I'm going to ask you afterwards, thank you, afterwards, would you just stand out there, and anybody else who wants to sign up for prayer time through the rest of this month for the McGee Project, if you want to go down and pray at McGee, you can. You can walk around, you go and pray there inside the hospital, or you can just pray outside, or if you just pray at home, feel free to do that, but sign up. It's getting pretty full, so we just encourage you to do that. So if you would just stand out there afterwards, okay, and they can sign up for that, we would greatly appreciate it. Yes, Abraham. I know I made fun of you, but that's all right. Oh, yes, yes, thank you, yes. Okay, what is that, 2,482? Okay. Yes, so there's luncheon today, and if you want to stay and help stuff those envelopes and get the mailing out, that would be great. Thank you. Well, I have said for a while, have I not, that the church, as we say in Pittsburgh, needs red it up, right? Red it up. That is, get cleaned up and cleaned out. Get cleaned up and cleaned out. a lot of you are doing that very thing in your homes. You know, you're cleaning out things, you're getting rid of things, you're reorganizing, you're doing all of that stuff, you know. It's like going into a closet and you see all kinds of stuff there in the closet shelf, and you have to do what? You got to purge. You got to get rid of. You got to take everything off and get rid of so that you can either get rid of what you don't need and move in what you do need. Okay? So we got to do that in the church. The church has got to get redded up or cleaned up and cleaned out. And let me tell you, the church, people have said the church is in bad shape. Well, let me tell you, I do believe that there's a lot going on in the church that needs to be cleaned up and cleaned out. But let me tell you, because of what happened in 2020, God has the church right where He needs it so that it can wake up to the call that God wants to do something amazing in our day. Because I tell you, if we do not believe that or hold on to that, then what hope do we have in this time and in this season? Let me tell you, it is time that we believe and know and understand that there is still an outpouring that is coming. God gave me that vision. God gave it to many people, God, that same vision. And Kathy, I was just thinking about this as I was preparing this. Remember that vision that I had of the tsunami coming down off of Mount Washington and overflowing, and you sent me that picture of that huge wave coming and crashing in on Pittsburgh. Let me tell you, I still got to believe and hold on to that is what God gave us, and God wants to do that, even though we've gone through and are going through what we are going through. But let me tell you this, church. In order for that to happen, the church has got to get cleaned up. It's got to get redded up and redded out. That's what it's got to do. We got to prepare for the outpouring. And so we need to understand that this goes all the way back to the birth of Messiah and the preparation in order for the people to receive the birth of Messiah, in order for them to receive Jesus' birth and to receive that, they had to hear the message of John the Baptist. If you will, turn to Mark chapter 1. Mark chapter 1. This is the message of John the Baptist. This is the preparation for the outpouring. In John the Baptist's day, he was preparing the people to receive the birth of the Messiah. Hello, folks. How are you today? I just saw you sitting over there. How nice. Welcome. Welcome. God bless you. Thank you for being here. Oh, excellent. Fantastic. Well, you can introduce yourselves to me later. Thank you, Brother Joel. I really appreciate that. Thank you so much. So John the Baptist, the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, is actually earlier than when you think. It is actually at the beginning with John the Baptist's message. The beginning of the gospel message starts with John the Baptist. In order for you to receive what Jesus proclaimed, you have to hear what John proclaimed. This is what he proclaimed. Behold, I send my messenger before your face who will prepare your way before you. The voice of one crying in the wilderness. And this is the voice. This is what we need today. This is the same voice we need today. Prepare the way of the Lord. Prepare the way of the Lord and make his path straight. You see, John came baptizing in the wilderness and preaching a baptism of what? What baptism? Of repentance. Let me tell you, the call has to go out. It is still the same call today. And what's going to red up and red out the church is a call to repentance. The church has got to repent as well as out. We say the world needs to repent. I say the church needs to repent. The church has got to get cleaned up. It has to fall on its face before Almighty God and say, forgive us, for we have sinned. We have sinned against you. Forgive us. John's message was a baptism of repentance for the remission of sins. Now notice what happens. Then all the land of Judea and those from Jerusalem went out to him and were all baptized by him in the Jordan River, confessing their sins. Now, John, they confessed. I tell you, Jesus, I pray that we will see all of America coming around and confessing their sins and getting baptized in the name of Jesus. May that be so in our day. Thank you, Lord. Yes. So all of Judea came. Now, John was clothed with what? Camel's hair. And with a leather belt around his waist. And he ate locusts and wild honey. And he preached, saying, there comes one after me who is mightier than I, whose sandal strap I am not worthy to stoop down and loose. I indeed baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. Whoo! Yeah, that's what we need. Come on, church. Wake up on this first Sunday of Advent. I know you're still full of Thanksgiving turkey and stuffing and sweet potatoes, and the list goes on. It's time to wake up, church. John the Baptist was the prophetic voice who came heralding the message of repentance and preparation for the coming of the Lord. And my friends, we presently find ourselves in another significant time of preparation and repentance as God is moving powerfully in the earth today. You think it all stopped? You think just because of COVID-19 that God stopped doing anything? Hallelujah! God is on the move! God is doing amazing things, and in and through this whole COVID mess. That's what it is. It's a mess. Powerfully, he's moving. Just like the act of cleansing out that shelf in your closet, we are preparing a place for his coming and for his outpouring. We are in a John the Baptist type of season where God is calling his people to make preparation for his outpouring. Let me tell you, we are in a John the Baptist season, and we got to get ready for the outpouring that he wants. I'll tell you, my friends, we can't be preaching cheap grace. No cheap grace today. No cheap grace from this pulpit. That's what I say, no cheap grace. I'm not here to pat you on the back saying, oh, you're just doing great, hallelujah, God bless you. No, I say, let's get right with God. Let's fall on our knees. Let's seek his face like never before. You see, when John the Baptist called for repentance, he was looking for a change of heart and mind. You see, true repentance isn't about our feelings. You know, it's amazing how much the church thinks everything's about its feelings. And isn't it amazing how so many people in the church think everything revolves around them? You know, you are the most important person in the church. You know that? Oh, boy, that's cheap grace. Okay, so true repentance isn't about our feelings, but is changing the way we think so that we will live out repentance. Let me tell you, repentance isn't a one-time act. You live out repentance the rest of your life. You live a life worthy of what Jesus Christ did on the cross for you. It isn't about just saying, oh, Jesus, forgive me for my sins, and just going on doing your old Mary thing, whatever you want to do. It is about living out that repentance. You got to work out your salvation with fear and with trembling. You with me, church? Because you see, where there is true repentance, there will be the fruit of repentance. People say that they repent and they're saved, and they live like the devil. They live like the devil. I say you got to repent and you got to live out that repentance in fear and trembling. False repentance wants to look, to give the look of repentance without really having your heart and mind truly changed. Brother Samuel said he felt like there was a word from the Lord today. You feel like this is a word from the Lord today, Samuel? Amen. Amen. See, Jesus later said in Matthew 23:25, woe to you teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites. You clean the outside of the cup and the dish, but inside they are full of greed and self-indulgence. You see, God, my friends, has graciously given us this time to prepare our hearts for his outpouring. Just like Isaiah spoke in Isaiah 43:4, he says, it is time to make straight the paths for him. I tell you, friends, we are going to see the crooked places made straight and the rough places smooth as his spirit moves through the earth. Do you know how many crooked places and ways there are in the church today? Do you know how many crooked places there are? The church has got to get straight and smooth, and every valley is going to be raised up and every mountain be made low, because let me tell you, the Lord wants to do a mighty thing in the church today. A mighty thing. My friends, this is an important time when we invite and allow the Spirit of God to go deep in our hearts and to heal and to flush out the impurities that may have taken up residence in our lives over time. And it happens, yes. This is not a time to focus on the outside of the cup and the dish, but to humbly receive him to make the inside clean before him. Now, I'm not talking about, just condemning yourself and beating yourself up and that unbalanced introspection. No, it is an invitation for him to do his work in our hearts, and we gladly and fully claim his words. 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Amen? Hallelujah. The second thing is, let's draw our attention for a second to wearing the camel skin. What does a camel skin represent? See, John the Baptist came wearing that camel skin, not unlike that of the prophet Elijah, 2 Kings 18. The same picture, the same scenario. It is significant because the angel prophesied to Zechariah, John the Baptist's father, in Luke 1:17. He said these words, and he will go on before the Lord in the spirit and power of Elijah, to turn the hearts of the parents to their children and the disobedient of to the wisdom of the righteous, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. Let me tell you, we need to have parents and children reunited and in one accord, and we need to have the disobedient in our society come to the wisdom of the righteous so that they will get ready for the outpouring that God wants to bring. Amen? Amen. Now you say, what is this about the camel skin that's important? Well, the camel skin was the humble clothing of a hermit or a poor man. That, along with John's diet of locusts and honey. Now, the honey I could take, but the locusts, I'm not so sure about that. Think about that. But my friends, that was in keeping with the unusual entrance of our Messiah, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, the King of the universe, the King of kings and Lord of lords. How did he come? In the most lowly of fashion, born in a manger, wrapped in strips of cloths. My friends, his humble entrance into our world was only recognized by the humble of heart and those who were willing to repent and to change the way they thought and understood. Oh, my friends, just as the children came to Jesus and the disciples said, shooed them away, Jesus said, truly, I tell you, unless you change and become like little children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Therefore, whoever takes the lowly position of this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. Oh, my friends, Jesus comes in unusual ways, doesn't he? Just as soon as you think you got him figured out, guess what? He shows up in an unexpected way. And then third and finally, our perceiving is related to the health of our hearts. I've been teaching a lot in Sunday school about body, soul, and spirit. The spirit, our hearts. Our perceiving is related to the health of our hearts. We know that the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, they totally missed this unusual entrance of John the Baptist in camel's hair and locusts and malt honey, and Jesus being born in that stable and laid in a manger. They missed all of that. They missed it. Heaven came down and was standing in their midst, and they couldn't even see it or perceive it. Jesus said there was nobody else born greater than John the Baptist. Nobody, and they missed it. And when asked what do they think about him, they said, we're not going to answer the question. Then Jesus said, well, I'm not going to answer your question. I'm not going to answer your question. Because if you can't see heaven slapping you in the face, then there's something wrong. There's something wrong. You see, why? Because our perceiving is related to the health of our hearts. If our hearts are unhealthy, if they're full of junk, like on that shelf you got to clear out. If your heart is full of junk, then you got to clean it out in order to perceive and understand what God wants to do in your life. You see, in preparation for Jesus coming, John the Baptist had to come. And he offered a way of repentance that would open, it would clean out the stuff in their hearts that they were able to see and perceive and understand and receive who Jesus was and receive his message. And what did they do? They left their shells all full of junk. In other words, they left their hearts full of the stuff that kept them from seeing clearly and perceiving. My friends, We've heard many times the scripture, Isaiah 43:19, but I believe God is saying this again. See, I am doing a new thing. I am doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? I am making a way in the wilderness and streams in the desert. In other words, he says, can't you see it? If you can't see it, you need to say, God, why can't I see it? Why can't I see it? And if I can't see it, help me to see it by cleaning out the junk in my life. Do you need a lot of junk cleaned out in your life? Do you need the shelves in your closet cleaned out, gotten rid of? Do you need to red up? Do you need to do that? Our spiritual perception of Jesus and his kingdom is related to the depth of healing and the repentance that we have received in our hearts. Maybe you are saved today, but maybe you need deliverance today. Maybe you didn't need delivered from a lot of things. Maybe there's like that onion skin that you need to peel this off and peel this off and peel this off. Maybe you need to get rid of that junk. The Spirit of God is longing to pour out more for each and every one of us. And how wonderful it is that he has given to us this gift of repentance. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, that's repentance, then I will hear from heaven, forgive their sin, and heal their land. As he touches those areas in your life and my life that are out of alignment with him, he releases a grace to repent and to step into truth and the fullness that he wants so that you and I can fully perceive him and his kingdom at work within us. Many people have asked and have been crying out, is there any hope for our nation? Is there any hope for our nation? Is there any hope for our cities? Come on! Is there any hope for our broken down families and relationships? If you say, oh, I don't know. I don't think there's any hope. Then ask God to change your perception here. Ask God to say, there is hope for America. There is hope for my family. There is hope for my city of Pittsburgh. There is hope for my church today. Come on, church. We got to get our perception changed. Because I believe the Spirit of the living God is saying this, make way, make way. Make way, make way. The King of glory is here. Woo! Lift up your heads to see, for I am moving even now. The Lord of glory says, I am blowing in to fill in the valleys and to bring the mountains low. For you are my instruments. You will be my instruments of change and restoration and transformation in all this earth. Humble your hearts before me and allow me to bring true grace for repentance that you might be able to see and perceive my coming. Oh, the Lord is saying, even now I am bringing waves of healing. Do you need healed today? Let him heal your body, soul, mind, and spirit. Come on, let him heal you. Come on, let him heal you. Receive it today. He says, I'm bringing healing. I'm bringing alignment. Do you need alignment today? You know when your car gets out of alignment, then the tires wear unevenly, you know that? Then let him do an alignment in your heart today. Do you need restoration in your lives today? Do you need restoration? Let God restore you. He is a God of restoration. Do you need refreshing? Oh, pray that times of refreshing may come today. Come on. Would you just allow yourselves to be caught up in his waves today? The Lord says, be caught up in my ways. Would you allow yourself to be swept up into something bigger and greater than yourself? The Lord says, so let go. Let go today. Don't hold on. Don't hold on. Let go. Let go. Let go. And let me sweep into new things and new purposes in your life. New assignments and new alignments await you. Let go of the old and perceive the new. I tell you, folks, we are shifting into high gear. Come on! You know when you shift it, you know when you're you know, stick shift. You know how many have driven a stick shift? Anybody? Very few. So you're in low gear and there's a lot of power, but you're it's slow going. You know, and you got to shift, and then you shift, and then you shift into high gear. And when you're shifting into high gear, it's just like you're just gliding. Let me tell you, church, God wants us to shift up into high gear today. Come on, let's get into gear number 5 today. We are shifting into a new dimension of his kingdom in all the earth. And then the scripture will be fulfilled, Isaiah 40, verse 3. Many will see and fear the Lord. Not coronavirus, fear the Lord. Not the state of the economy, fear the Lord. Not the state of who won the election, but fear the Lord. Come on, let's get it right. And then put their trust in him. Put their trust in him. So as you allow him to breathe those life-changing winds of preparation, clean out that shelf and repentance. Get rid of it and blow into your life. Repent. Open your hearts and let Jesus fully come in. The song we're going to sing today, you may not realize it or know it as a Christmas carol, but it is. And it's a beautiful Christmas carol. And it just, thou didst leave thy throne. This song talks about the entire story of salvation. From Jesus coming down to earth, his ministry, his death, and his coming again. Because you know what? The only thing that makes all of this even bearable is that Jesus is coming again. But the chorus simply says, oh, come to my heart, Lord Jesus. Do you need healing today? Do you need an alignment today? Restoration, refreshing? Do you need to repent today? This altar is for you today. Simple as that. This altar is for you. Would you come? Would you pray? If you can't kneel, sit and let God do the work that only he can do. Stand with me if you would, please. Happening here. It's fleshing out the whole gospel story right here. He left heaven. He came down to earth. Nowhere could anybody lay there. Everybody had a place to lay their head except Jesus. Come on. Oh, come to my heart, Lord Jesus.
The foxes found rest and the birds their nest in the shade of the forest tree. But thy couch was the sod. Oh, thou Son of God.
Terry, this is the last verse here. It talks about Jesus coming again. Let me just ask you a simple question. Are you ready for Jesus to come again? If he were to come right now, this moment, bursting through those eastern skies, are you ready for Jesus? If not, I encourage you to come and let's pray. Maybe you've been a Christian for a long, long time, but you need to get that shelf cleaned up. You need to get redded up today. Maybe you need to come and pray this morning. Maybe you need healing in your body, soul, mind, and spirit. Maybe. Maybe you just need restoration. Maybe you need just a refreshing. Who doesn't need a refreshing, huh? Come on down.
When the heaven shall ring and her choir shall sing at thy coming to victory, let thy voice call me home, saying, yeah, there is room at my side. For
will Jesus say that to you?
My heart shall rejoice, Lord Jesus, when thou comest and callest for me. Oh, come to my heart, Lord Jesus. There is room in my heart for.
Is your life and heart, is it just full of all kinds of stuff? It doesn't have any room for Jesus today? Make room. Repent. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, I want to lift up these that have gathered around the altar, and no doubt there are others that have been moved as well this morning. But I just pray that you will just help them to clean out those shelves, those areas in their lives. Maybe they need a healing touch today. Maybe they need restoration today, Jesus. Maybe they just need refreshing today. Let me pray over you today. Lord, I'm just praying for these that are gathered here today. I'm asking, oh God, that you'll just touch them. Whatever their need is, Lord, healing, restoration, renewal, refreshing, whatever it is, oh God, touch them, Jesus. Heal them, Lord. Be what they need you to be. And Lord, I am praying for this flock that, Lord Jesus, you will just speak to them today. Bring restoration. But restoration only comes when repentance is done. So Lord, let's get it right in the right order. Let's repent and be restored. Let's repent and be healed. Let's repent and be refreshed today. And so Lord, I'm praying that we'll just red up whatever that needs to be, red it up in our lives today so that we can receive the fullness of the blessing that you have for us, that we may receive the outpouring that you want to bring. Lord, I know you are not done with us. I know you're not done with this church. I know you're not done with Pittsburgh. I know you're not done with America. I know you're not done with the movement that you promised. You are going to bring it, but help us to prepare for that coming today. In Jesus' glorious, matchless name. Amen. Amen, amen. Receive God's blessing today, church. Receive it today in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Amen.